breathe, I smile. Every one of you in this room, today you have your own soul, you have your own sound. How long has it been since you just got lost with you in here? Forget about all of these other people. You ain't even here today. It's me and him. Listen to my song for you today, boy. Listen to my sound. Listen to me, boy. I just want to be right at your feet. Just leave me at your throne. Leave me there all alone. Me and you. To be surrounded in your glory. That's a good place to be, boy. Where all the stuff and the junk goes away, gets out. It's where that mending takes place and the healing flows at your throne. Me and you, all alone. Take me to the King. Take me to the King. Oh my goodness. I think he's here. What are you waiting on? What else are you waiting on? Drove him around for 3 hours trying to decide where and what to do. time too, but I was scared at one time. 9 years old. You know what? You don't have to be a big old man, 68 years old, to move the heart of God. You can do it at 9 years old. Yeah. 9 years old is when I started my ministry. 9 years old, this age.
Right here.
In front of 3,000 people just called me up one day. Somebody heard I played piano. Nobody ever heard me. I didn't think at this big convention, and the keyboard player didn't show up. And anybody play a piano? 3,000 people. Somebody said, Billy Joe can, and I hope you go into the seat. I said, surely there's another Billy Joe, but that's a horrible name. Surely nobody had that name. That's where I started, 9 years old. Your age, my friend. Listen, that guy drove him around that town for 3 hours. And what did that little boy do? He started singing. Arsenio said, where did you learn this song? Church. Well, you could have sang, he called somebody's name, Shakira. You could have sang Michael Jackson. You could sing the Star-Spangled Banner. Why did you sing this song? He said, because I knew Jesus was with me. Exactly. Boldness. And he said, well, what's that favorite part of your song? And the young man says, well, the whole song's my favorite part of the song. He said, well, what is your very special favorite part? He says, this part, it says. And he said, Arsenio said, sing a little bit of it. He started singing. What is it?
God, my Savior, God, my healer,
said, God, my deliverer. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. We don't know what to say. God, the deliverer.
Yeah.
a 9-year old. And you tell me there's not power in your praise. You tell me there's no power in your praise. He was all alone, all by himself. He didn't have no cell phone to call his mama or his daddy, or to call the pastor, or to call the TV based on prayer line. All he knew to do was what was down inside of him. He did what he was created to do, and he lifted up his sound, his voice, and he sung it, and he sang it till he got his brain. A week from Wednesday night, that's the 14th, we're going to have
charge $10 to give you an awesome meal. You can't beat that anywhere in town. So if you'll be here a week from Wednesday night, 6:30, 7, whenever you get here, we're going to have a fundraiser. Our youth camps are out of sight. So we want to help raise the money of our youth camp. It's almost like it's become the highlight of our year because our youth are so, so important. And you only see about half of them this morning. There's another whole group that shows up on Wednesday night, and then there's another whole group that comes to youth camp, and we've been praying and praying. Somebody shout, household,
household
salvation. We have many, many people that are connected to this church that their household is not saved. We're believing God for household salvation. So if you'd be here a week from Wednesday night, we're going to have a fundraiser for our youth camp. Anybody ever heard this scripture? Without faith, it is what? Impossible to please God. He who comes to God must what? Believe that he is and that he is a rewarder. He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. This morning, I was just reading over some of my daily reading, and I came across that scripture, you know, that says the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the righteous.
Yeah.
And I noticed in Ecclesiastes, it says it like this: for God gives wisdom and knowledge and joy to a man or woman who is pleasing in his sight. So if it's impossible to please God without faith, then you please God by believing that his word is what he says it is. Faith, you believe in his word. So God gives you wisdom and knowledge and joy to the person who is pleasing in his sight. And then it goes in to say, but to the sinner, he gives the work of gathering and collecting that he may give it to him who is pleasing to the Lord. So he quote that God is going to give the wealth of the wicked to the righteous, to those that please him, to those who walk by faith. I don't know about you, that kind of gave you a little different perspective on that scripture, because I want to please God. I want to please God because I love God for all that God is and does for me. But I also want to please him because I want to receive some of that wealth. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together. Amen. So as you prepared yourself to give this morning, we thank you for being here. This is a very giving church. I want to compliment you and thank you. You have been very faithful through the years. And our percentage of givers, Dr. Lea, is way ahead of our average. We thank God for that. Amen. So I want to pray over your offering, and we're going to receive our offering this morning. Father, we thank you so much for this service, for all the great people of God that are here, every person that's here. We give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. We speak blessings over the people as they give. In Jesus' name, amen. You would stand and bring your offering as an act of worship.
Should we lose our way?
thank you for the light, Lord. Oh, we hold it in our hearts. When stars go out each night, Lord, remind us where you are. Let this be our prayer when shadows fill our days. Oh, sweet Jesus, lead us to that place. Lord, guide us with your grace to a place where we'll be safe. A world where pain and sorrow will be ended, and every heart that's broken will be mended, and we'll be
wedding, that song was sung, the prayer was sung, and I heard her playing. I said, the prayer, and Bill says to me, you want me to sing? That's how we have church, that we don't know what we're going to do, but our eyes are on him. And I leaned over and I said, we're going to renew our vows with the Lodge Hotel. I'm going to invite you and your beautiful wife Renee that I've known since 1974. I was the first Baptist ever heard of speaking tongues. I can't do that. And it changed your life that day. We all were changed that day. Scared him. It wasn't supposed to be happening. Since then, my God, what we've walked through and how we Shelly and Celine Dion cannot touch what I just heard. There's one thing to sing with great, great, great talent. Another thing to sing with great talent and anointing. That's why you feel what you feel right now. I just imagine you sitting in the presence not of Larry Lea. Pastor, before I ask you to be seated, would you come sit on my right hand, please, Pastor David? And Roger Lance, please come sit on my left hand, please. These are the only two men that know the severity of this service right now and the reality of this service in my life. Last time I was here, they had to lift me up to get me into the truck that my dear brother there was driving. Some 63-year-old man just in the natural have trouble getting in that truck. But I've been able to leap over troops and run through walls until something happened. I didn't even know what was going on, but for 45 days I had an inguinal hernia. It was 6 inches long. And the outer lining of my colon had gone down into it and cut off the circulation all the way down my leg. And Darryl Lea gave me a book to read. And it was nothing but scriptures. And I lived on that book now. And I couldn't crawl up in the bed on the next Friday after the Sunday I was here. My wife said, I'm taking emergency room, something's bad wrong. And I said, that's fine. I don't care. I'm not afraid of doctors. Amen. I believe in prayer and medicine. I believe in what God heals that you be healed. Am I right? So I said, no fear there. And I said, all right, baby. And when she said it, I said, amen. Because she's a green-eyed Jew. And you better listen to green-eyed Jews. I'm married to a green-eyed Jew. Amen. Who believes more than you all and speaks in tongues more than you all. Amen. But anyway, God bless her, and she took the emergency room. They did an MRI. It just happened to be a man named Dr. Jacoba walking through. He's leading a surgeon in Kansas City. And he looked at that MRI and said, man, you're dying. So you have no blood running through your body from here down. And that means it's clogging up everywhere else. Y'all understand? Your heart could explode any minute. With as much radiation as they did 13 years ago, but I never had cancer again. Amen. He said, you don't know how bad this is. Have you been driving a lot? I said, well, I just drove 3,000 miles in the last 6 days. That's a lot. And I've been on the road now for 44 years. So I guess I've been traveling some. I don't know. Thank you so much for standing in the presence. Said, how have you taken the pain? Because what this is equal to is a somewhat, anybody here had ever had a heart attack? A real thing right there. It felt like you had a heart attack. Did it hurt? Yeah. He said, oh yeah. He said, the pain you've experienced, how long has it been like this? I said, 4 weeks. What have you been doing? I said, I preached 3 prayer schools, 7 lessons per school in 3 different churches. That's what I've done since this started. He said, you've been doing it in the middle of a heart, the equal pain of a heart attack, 24/7. How'd you do that? I said, I did. I got somebody living in me greater. And I just kept going till right now. And when I couldn't get up in bed, my wife made me come talk to you. I said, well, I'm operating on you first. And he just happened to be walking through. Number one surgeon. He said, now this is an 8-week recovery, which would be now, just about, maybe not that, it hadn't been quite that long, but I said, well, if you're a good surgeon, you can tie me back together, and I'll be preaching again this time next week, and I was. I haven't felt a moment's pain. Until then, I really believe that you gave me, put me alive. But the doctor said I was supposed to be dead, because the blood had backed up in my body for 4 weeks. I'd had no blood running from here all the way down my leg. That means it's clogging somewhere else, blowing out arteries and blowing out everything else. And I'm going to tell you all about this church. I want y'all to hear what I'm going to say. There's miracles present when you meet and worship God. Pastor Roger, I'm so glad you're here with your wife and your son Rocky, who goes to Oral Roberts University. Sarah, this man has been a senior pastor of his own church. He for 17 years served another church as a senior associate pastor, and now he is the truest Timothy us will do things together as God gives me my life. But right now, I have a project that it was supposed to cost $50,000, and after I talked to the people, they said $25,000, and now I've got them, after I talked to them one more time, they said $12,000. Did y'all hear what I just said? That it's going to change, not, it's going to change thousands of lives, because it's going to change my life. And I can't say anything else about it, because God told me not to. But I told him, and I told him, because I trust them. This is an amazing thing that only God knows, but it is real as rain. And I am having them stand beside me because I believe so strongly in the prayer of agreement. How many of y'all recognize this is not just in the natural world? The man back there on the back gave me a coat when I was here last time. It was the middle of that storm that hit Kansas City. He gave me a coat with gloves and a tie around the neck. It was a beautiful cashmere coat. I mean, it was gorgeous. I'm not full length. I wore it every day in that prayer room. I'm the apostolic prayer advisor to the whole International House of Prayer movement, now global. That's a $25 million a year ministry with the university. 250 acres just given to them. Harry Truman's land is just given to them. I hope y'all heard what I just said. I'm the advisor to that thing. I go Tuesday to take an old seminary to retool it into a fivefold ministry seminary. I leave on Tuesday to do that. There's stuff I got to do in my body. But there's stuff got to happen to my body, and God knows what it is. And I'm in a position to have it done quickly and fast. And I believe somebody here could testify that out of my mouth has come words that have helped change their life. Is there anybody here who could like raise their hand and say testimony to that? I can't stop traveling. I can't stop preaching. And I got people telling me I have to now. And I know I'm not supposed to. I had two different ones tell me. I sit in a chair. Two different doctors' offices. They said, you got to. I left the office. I said, because there's a place I'm going to go in Tulsa. Miracles happen. I'm standing in that place right now. This is my number one. I don't know. This is, you don't know who number one is. This is the number one. And I hate to call him Junior because we're so close to age. But yet he's an associate. You understand what I'm saying? He works for me and gets so he tithes to me. I'm trying to figure that out. But Paul would tell you about it. Amen. He had a Timothy. Amen. This is my number one. Y'all got to know this is my number one church. This is not a large church, but it's the one. That God said, keep going back there. Not just because Pastor Sears loves me and helps me and blesses me and encourages me and my friend, but because of the presence that comes in this room. And why people aren't standing outside the door, I still don't know. It may be God's waiting for me to move here in hell. I don't know, but I will if God's speaking. I'll be right here. I'll sit on the back row too. I don't care. I'm not covetous of any man's church. I pastored a little church one time. I pastored three little churches one time. And I started about 50. So I don't need anything like that. What I need is to be in the presence. How many of y'all feel that right now? He said, man, I don't like to preach a lot. Because these men have already preached my sermon for us. Amen. But I want y'all to come in agreement because something is about to happen. It was prophesied last night. He was standing there. I don't know Grant, I don't know Jones. Jones is a pastor. The Jones family are commercially very wealthy musicians, okay? The family you met last night, they have made a fortune doing what they do. But Daddy is a prophet, okay? And it's all the children are singing, and it's unbelievable the sounds they made last night. Am I right? These are real musicians here. All I know is what I like. These are professionals here. And I sat there, and Jones, who I'd never met in my life, said, I found out later, from Yakima, Washington, never met him before. He stopped the whole meeting. He says, Dr. Larry, Every word he said, I dreamed it. I woke up dreaming it, thinking I was already there. And so, you said it a minute ago, well, some things shifted and they needed to. Brother, you have no idea what you said. But could y'all reach your hands out while they lay hands on me and just Pastor David pray, and then Brother Roger, I call him Sir Roger. This is Sir Roger Lance because he represents such a royalty to me in the kingdom. Pastor David, I need your prayer. Would you pray for me?
Father, we come in agreement according to your word. According to what you said, we come in the authority of the name of Jesus, the name above every name. We don't ask you to heal, Dr. Lea. We command his body to be made whole because you promised it, paid for it. So we command him to be made whole from the top of his head to the sole to the tip of his toes. In the name of Jesus, somebody praise him that God has already done the work. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
We thank you for your gratefulness today. Hallelujah. We thank you that you are a great God. You have no beginning and no end. Hallelujah. And we thank you today, Father, that every gift and good thing you have for us. And today, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I'm declaring that you will speak, Lord, to each one of us on how we can give to the man of God to cause the man of God to keep going. We thank you, Father, that there is no delay in your kingdom. Yes. Hallelujah. And Lord, today in the name of Jesus, I declare and decree, make it known into this atmosphere that in Jesus' name every need is supplied according to your riches and glory through Christ Jesus that lives and dwells within us. And in Jesus' name, I thank you, Father. We decree that, Lord, today this need is met. It's met today in Jesus' name because of the sound that's in this house and the spirit of the Lord Jesus Christ that's in this place that rests in this place in Jesus' name.
Yes, ma'am. Amen. Give God one more clap offering. Thank you, God. Thank you, Pastor. You may be seated. I'm going to preach a message today from 2 Chronicles chapter 20. Which again has already been lived out here before you, and many of the words already spoken. But just amazing how God works. I was going to say a moment ago, how many of you recognize we're in a time of change of season? Somebody said, this is my time for change of season. I mean, it is your season to change, amen. Not just the weather to change, but your season to change. The coat that was given to me represented I needed a coat for that season. And Kansas City, my God, it was frozen for 2 months. I literally frozen for 2 months. Everywhere I've moved, the weather has changed significantly, and I'm not bringing it to my Lord or my flesh. I'm just going to tell you, signs, wonders, and miracles in the heavens, talking about weather patterns, will go where apostles go. And when we moved to Oklahoma City, they will tell you that was when the 500-year rain hit. Went to Kansas City and the place froze longer than it's ever been frozen at one time in the history of the state. And he gave me the coat that I bore it under. Amen. And I bless you again, sir. Thank you. And he gave it to me in tears, great love, and just compassion for God. And I love you for it. Now, I'm standing before you today telling you it is time for the change of your season. 2 Chronicles chapter 20 is a very familiar passage. The text and the title go together because I take the title of the message from the text itself. In 2 Chronicles 20, you remember Jehoshaphat was literally surrounded by two and a half nations that they had let off the hook. They could have literally fought them and defeated them on their own, but they let them off the hook because they were cousins. And so they said, we're not bothering them. But now these 2.5 nations come against them to destroy them. And the title of the message is simply, what to do when you don't know what to do. Because when you read it, if I hadn't told you that first part, you wouldn't understand what he's talking about. But they had let these two and a half nations off the hook. And they didn't go. go in and destroy them. They went by them. But when Israel got one place, here came those 2.5 nations to kill them and pull them out of their land, out of their place. And so here they are in a position they cannot win in the natural. I'm gonna say something right now. You will remember, you're not having a test if you get out of it on your own. Did you hear what I just said? If you can get through this without the help of God, that's not a biblical test. And there'll be no testimony be worth anything. But when you're in something you can't get out of without God intervening supernaturally, then that's a test. Anybody here ever been through a test? All right, so you know where they were. They were in a test. This was only a test, but at the same time, it was a severe test. It was a life or death test. It was a quit or go on test. And we have read this passage before, but I pray you'll get new ears. Somebody just say, open my ears that I can hear it. Anybody got a ear to hear? Listen now. Because it's more important. The man of God said, I read Larry Lea's book on the hearing ear. And he said, I started hearing. Larry Holly was his name. He just helped Gary McIntosh pay off his building. Y'all didn't hear that. Raised $400,000 plus in one service. And this last weekend for Gap Standards raised $160,000 plus what came in yesterday morning amongst less than 200 people. And it was nothing in the flesh. There was not one thing done in the flesh. I stood up as an apostle of God saying this was of God. There was not any pull. There was no manipulation. There was an anointing on that man to produce supernatural signs, wonders, and miracles. God woke me up and said, this is the first man, other than those you already assigned to, that you pray for regularly. You are on assignment to him, like Brother Wilhite is on assignment to me, who's now 85 years old, my pastor. I want you to hear what I'm about to say. Jehoshaphat and all the children of Israel made a confession of reality. They told the story as it was. They did not elaborate. They did not try to work themselves into faith. Because faith is a grace gift by hearing. Amen. Y'all hear anything? Faith cometh. Somebody say the first part of that is important. Faith what? Cometh. It cometh. It cometh. It's something that comes by hearing. Now our praying is important, but it's more important what you hear than what you say. And so most of my prayer life is not speaking, it's hearing. And I go 3 hours at a shot, but most of that time is hearing. For every 3 hours, I'll spend 2 hours hearing and 1 hour speaking. But that's average, and that's daily. You say, well, but I can't pray like that. I can't pray that long. Let me tell you something. When it's life or death, you'll pray. When the enemy's there, 2.5 nations about to destroy you, some of y'all are in those situations right now. But how many, let me just find out, how many in this room right now got one thing that you don't know what to do about? There's something you're dealing with. I don't know how to make this work any better than what it is. And I need God's intervention. Can I see your hand again? And the rest of y'all just listen, because you'll be there soon. Amen. But God sets these things up, see, in order to push us through to the next place. I could entitle this message From Bewilderment to Blessing. Because they were bewildered. And so they got real. And in verse 12 of this great Second Chronicles, this passage has been preached. Most of you have heard it all your life, but possibly never under this topic. They said, oh, our God, will you not judge them? Now, this is an amazing thing, because God had led them to be kind to these nations. And now those nations, same one they've been nice to, come and trying to kill them. I just want to say, anybody has to live off your crumbs will end up hating your guts. reason for why they couldn't get it themselves. But I said something. For we have no power against this great multitude that is coming out against us. And then he says, nor do we know what to do. We don't know what to do, but... And he gives 17 things he did. Now, I'm not going to go through all 17 because I haven't got it in 2 hours. But I'm going to make major points here around the 17 things. And you go study this out, and you may find more than I did. But I found 17 things that I will not deal with now. But he says, neither know we what to do, but our eyes are upon you. Somebody say divine shift. There had to come a divine shift in their focus. Their focus for the moment when they're praying this is on the incredible bewilderment that's in their own mind, heart, and soul over something they could not win on their own. So they had to shift their attention and look unto Jesus. Are y'all listening? The Bible says, where are we to look? Look unto Jesus. Why? He is the author and the finisher. He is the Alpha and the Omega. If you have any faith, trust me now, it came, you didn't produce it, amen, yeah, you say, well, it came from the scriptures. Well, let me tell you something, preaching the word is so important, but many people search the scriptures because in them they think they have eternal life. Now, the Spirit breathed out the scriptures, and I'm an inheritist. That means I believe every word is inspired of God, and is profitable for doctrine, and so on and so forth. I believe the Bible as much as any preacher you have ever heard preach in your life. I fought for the veracity of God's word. And I'm alive because of it. But until the Holy Spirit comes and it becomes a sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, it's more Bible study and it's more Bible, which we need to do, memorization or whatever. But without the quickening of the Spirit upon the living word of God that's in this book to you, it won't do you any good. Now, I don't know if y'all understood what I just said, but if you didn't understand it, ask God to give you understanding. Because you've got to hear something for yourself in your own spirit. Papa Hagen, he understood that. Everything he did out of prayer. Dr. Cho said, how did you make your sermon, Larry Lee? That's the greatest sermon I ever heard an American preach. I said, I prayed in the spirit. Until I heard something that I knew was of God, I settled in on peace about what I was supposed to preach on. Then I added the best scholarship to the word of God I could do, and I stood up and preached, thus saith the Lord. I didn't preach this as my sermon. I hope it blesses you. And that's the difference between the Western church in America and the Eastern church over there in Korea and China, which, by the way, are having massive revivals and can't get people in their buildings. And we can't beg people to come to church and get them. What's the difference? The word of the Lord is alive, quick, powerful, sharp, healing, delivering. And so I pray that the Holy Spirit can penetrate our hearts and our minds when we think we know it all. The Lord will put us in a situation when we don't know what to do. What to do when you don't know what to do? The first thing is shift your attention. Look to Jesus. Look to Him Himself. Yes, we study the scriptures, but in them we think we have eternal life, and they are they which testify of Jesus. Did you hear what I just said? They, the scriptures, are the testify of a relationship with a living Jesus. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, Bill. Said it, sang it a minute ago better than I can preach it. When I wrote, Could You Not Tarry 1 Hour, it came out of that old hymn. And the joy we share while we tarry there, I pulled that out of that instead of Could You Not Wait With Me or Pray With Me 1 Hour, I pulled that out and put Terry in there. Because my grandmother tarried before the Lord. She understood it. She would read her Bible and sit there and rock in her rocking chair. And I mean, that's where she would say, oh, little Larry, someday you're going to know this. And my God, my God, my God, she's been in heaven for a long time, but she's still in that great cloud of witnesses praying. Because if Jesus is praying and she's following and worshiping Jesus, she's praying too. And we don't pray to saints. Amen. But I guarantee you, saints are praying for us. Amen. I mean, believe Jesus is praying in heaven. Amen. How many people up in heaven are doing what Jesus is doing? Think about it. So before we leave this room today, Jesus will call up your name to God. Amen. You know what's wonderful about the saints in heaven? They can't see anything bad because there are no tears in heaven. But they're able to see what you do in the spirit realm that's good. And they pray for you for the eternal purposes that the Lord Jesus is praying according to the speaking of the blood that's there at the altar for you, speaking for you. And when they hear him pray, they enter into those intercessions with worship and praise nonstop. And that's what that's what they're attempting to do, and they are doing at the International House of Prayer in Kansas City. They've been going 14 years, 24 hours a day, Bill, with worship bands playing. There's about 60 bands, and they have to be good enough, professional enough, to make their own record before they get on the stage. So we're not talking about kids up there trying to play a guitar and finding the chord. We're talking about people that know how to move in the Spirit. They had an 800-seat auditorium that's packed 24/7 for 14 years. That's why I live 50 yards from that room. That makes sense, doesn't it? Where God would put the Apostle of Prayer is right there. And I walk across there. I just walk 50 yards. That's a half sandwich. Amen. For you golfers, you want to know what that is. Amen. I hit a sandwich about 95 yards. That's a half sandwich. I'm in the prayer room. So I love it. I love it there. And at the same time, we're merging more of Pentecostal experience with the vineyard waiting on God move. Both are right. They just need to be merged together. They're just prismatic, different ways of coming at God. And God brought me there with Mike Bickle, who has been my friend for 35 years. That's all. And we spent 50 hours together. And he said, "Man, I need you here." And I said, "I'm already here." And he could not believe it that I put both my dogs, my wife, my 14-year-old boy in the car and drove there. We celebrated Christmas at the motel at La Quinta in Amarillo, Texas, to get to the One Thing Conference, and there was only 40,000 people there. And I spoke to international leaders, 600 of them, and all of them I had met somewhere in the world traveling for the last 23 years. Some of them from Hong Kong, some of them, I had one guy pulling on me and said, "Will you go pray for the Pope? I'm the liaison to the Pope for the charismatic renewal," not just the Catholic Church that's crossing over to the charismatic community and all the body of Christ. "I'm the liaison, and you preach to us in Berlin, Germany. That's who I am. Now, would you please come and go with me this year and pray with the Pope in Rome?" He told me to give me the nations of the world with great suffering. And I said, "I can handle the sufferings if you give me the nations." Come on, somebody. Help me praise the Lord. I'm not glorifying myself. I'm telling you that it costs you something. And at the same time, if you're willing to walk it out with him, you'll see things you can't believe with your own eyes. And the best is really and truly yet to come. I'm a young 63-year-old. Look at me. Hey, but then look at him who made me whatever I am by his grace. He's the author, the finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before me endured the cross. He endured the suffering. Ought not Christ to have suffered to enter his glory? He endured the cross by means of despising the shame so that he could sit down in the finished work that he was given to do. And so he had a work he had to finish, Roger. That's why he went through what he went through. Now, you're going through something. You don't know what to do. That's okay. Because getting through it, okay, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'm going through this thing. Like I went through what I went from the time I saw you last to this moment. I went through that and back on my feet today preaching with more fire in my bones than I had when I was 21 years old, 22 years old, met Bill and Renee Morris. Y'all, this is getting gooder and gooder, is what I'm saying. And so there is a moment in time when you don't know what to do, so I'm going to take my eyes off. That's another way of saying I'm going to stop worrying about it. Because your brain is so big, it's about this big, compared to his brain that is infinitesimal. Y'all understand what I just said? It's beyond knowledge. So he says, stop worrying about it. Told you about the lady whose kid was kidnapped that we got back. Same kind of thing, a little different than the story that was on Arsenio the other night, but thank God for Arsenio that put that on. Yes, national television. God bless Arsenio. He's out of church too. I'm going to tell y'all something. He was birthed in and through church himself. And and he did that on purpose, by the way. He was saying, "Thank you, Jesus," himself. I know what Arsenio. But in this circumstance, the kid had been kidnapped, and the woman was so hysterical when I got to the house, the mama was, the FBI was there. I mean, they had the control center set up. They'd done the Amber Alert. It was absolutely a crazy thing of activity. And I walked in, and the mama come fall on the pastor and start crying. Oh, pastor, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? And what came out of my mouth was so contrary to what was going on all around me. I said, first thing I'm going to do is stop worrying about it. She said, well, if we're not going to worry about it, what are we going to do about it? I baited her. Y'all understand what I did? I said, the Bible says don't worry about anything, not even your kidnapped child. Now, that's not easy to do in the flesh. Matter of fact, you can't do it in the flesh. But we're going to get in the spirit, but in everything, everything. Yeah, in everything by first prayer. Because prayer is not just talking to God, it's what? It's hearing. Come on, somebody. Y'all out there? Am I going to have to come shake you? Prayer is talking to God, but the better part is Him talking back to you. Lord, if that's you, bid me come into the other water. He put His eyes, He shifted His eyes from something that was scaring them to death. They thought it was a ghost walking on the water. But Peter had the good sense when he heard the voice. He said, if that's really you, Jesus, bid me come into thee on the water. And He just said, come. One word. Not a lesson. Not a teaching. A word to do something. And He stepped out of the boat. And yes, he sunk when he took his eyes off. But I don't emphasize that as much as the fact that he stepped out. He moved on the word. He heard the word and he moved on the word. This is your change of seasons. If you want to experience the miracle that God has for you, in the midst of what you don't know what to do, you got to do something during your time of change of seasons. Whatever He says to do, you do it. And you'll see that whatever you poured into the water pot, hallelujah, you put something in. I like what Larry Holly said the other night. He said, fill it up with water. They had to put water in the water pots because Jesus is not a magician. He creates something from something. Give me the 5 loaves and 2 fish. If He had just said, everybody be fed, food would just appear right in their face. But He took it, He blessed it, He broke it, He spoke. Somehow he had the water pots all full, and then the water was turned into wine. Jesus is not a magician. He's a miracle worker. Are y'all hearing anything in this? You've got to shift your eyes to the miracle worker. The moment Peter put his eyes back on Jesus and said, Lord, save me, I'd rather be out of the water getting saved by Jesus sitting in the boat scared to death. Trying to calculate how I can work this out on my checkbook. How can I work this out with my situation that I'm in right now? If you could figure it out, it would already be done. Some of y'all have been working on stuff for years and years and can't get it finished. And so God is saying, shift your attention. Get your eyes off this thing. Put your eyes on Him and literally block your reasoning. Now, I'm not talking about murder your brain. If you have to think, if there are things you have to work your way through, that's fine. But my budget got so huge at one time, I couldn't even figure the numbers. And I'm working with a computer. I have a PhD. I can figure stuff out. But it was so huge, I couldn't see how we were going to get from here to there, from week to week. We never missed a paycheck. We never missed a payment. We never had told an employee, you can't get a salary this week. How did that happen? I looked at Him. I prayed. Now watch this. And then I heard, I'm your provider. Word I already had in me, but it came alive by the Spirit in me. I spoke the word, you're my provider. And then I started praising. Did y'all ever notice prayer came first? Now that's the Philippian church. Y'all remember when they were in the Philippian jail? It said first at midnight, Paul and, what was it, Silas, they prayed first. Is prayer just talking to God? It's talking and hearing something back. Then they sang praises to God. This goes right along here. All of a sudden, Jehoshaphat, who was the son of somebody, son of somebody, son of somebody, who was the son of somebody. That means he was nobody. They were trying to tell y'all who he was or who he was about to be. Now he became somebody. Later on, but right then he wasn't nobody. But when the clarion word of the Lord came, and in the old covenant that was the normal way it happened. outside in. With us, in the new covenant, it comes from the inside out. And Jesus said, that's better. Somebody say it's better. How many rather have inside information than somebody having to come tell you all the time what it is? Now, I believe in external prophecy, but at the same time, I'm walking with him. I'm walking and living in a word. I don't live by bread alone. I hadn't eaten any bread yet today. Amen. In the natural. But brother, I ate something that I'm living on right now. And Jehoshaphat stands up and prophesies, and I love what he said. And I'm just going to read it just because it's so good. Listen to this. He says, I love this. Here's somebody that somebody's son. They're saying he ain't nobody. That's what they're saying. They're trying to identify him, but they can't quite pick him out. But when the trumpet of the Lord started coming through him, he said, listen, all Judah. Brother, when they heard that sound, there was a certain sound. God is tonal. And men of God in the apostolic fivefold ministry can hear the tone of something that's of the Spirit. That's the Spirit. Now, just a moment ago, I said, Bill and Renee sang that better than Bocelli and Celine Dion. Didn't mean they hit notes better. It meant there was anointing on it. That I would rather have them sing it my renewal of our vows than if Celine and Bocelli would fly in and sing it for me. And I mean that before God. I say it. Listen to what it says. Listen to me, all Judah and inhabitants of Jerusalem, king. He's the king of Israel. Thus says the Lord, don't be afraid. That's first. The angel of the Lord always come and say, don't be afraid. First thing he always said, don't be afraid. Jesus saying, first thing, always, don't be afraid. Somebody just get it in your mouth. I'm not going to be afraid. You know what? When I came down here, I knew there was something bad wrong with me last time. I mean, I was hurting so bad. I knew I was hurting. When you hurt, nobody has to tell you you're hurting. But I was dealing with it. Because sometimes you deal with it.
That's right.
You give God a chance to work with you.
That's right.
I just dealt with the pain.
Amen.
When you're in the seventh game of the playoffs, Magic Johnson that won the playoff one year when he was playing, he had a turned ankle, he had a bad shoulder, he had one eye he had one eye black, and he looked like he'd been a prize fight with Mike Tyson on a bad day. Amen. And they said to Magic, how are you going to play the next game with all this pain? He said, I'm going to deal with it. I never forgot that. Because a lot of times I've just had to deal with it. Amen. Do not be afraid. Somebody say, I'm not going to be afraid. That next word is interesting, nor dismayed. That's different than afraid. Dismayed means disheartened or depressed. I think depression hurts people or is more prevalent today than fear. And that leaves people, if you're afraid and dismayed, you're numb. That's equal to catatonia, which basically means you are just, the lights are on but nobody's home. Y'all with me? Because this great multitude from the battle is not yours, but it's God's. Tomorrow! Now, he didn't say 6 months from now. He said, tomorrow, go down to the cliff at Ziz, because they're coming up at the cliff at Ziz. Somebody tell me where the cliff of Ziz is. Hey, I always like to say that. I don't know why, but the deal is, do y'all understand what I'm saying? You don't know what the enemy's up to necessarily. You don't know where the battle really is or what you're supposed to do. You don't know what to do, but God knows exactly where it is. He knows exactly where to position you. He knows exactly what's going on. He said, tomorrow the enemy's going to be coming up the cliff at Ziz. I said, where is the cliff at Ziz? How many don't know where the cliff at Ziz is? No. Just like you don't know how to win in this battle. You don't know how to get what you are after. But yet you know there's something there.
Yeah.
How many know there's something more for you right now than what you've had?
Yeah.
And you say, well, I'm 75 years old. I'm already coming. Please, please, please. When Moses was 80 years old, he started his ministry.
That's right.
So, well, that's back in the Bible times, and that was Moses. No, God is no respecter of persons. Please, please believe God right now. He can do more with you in 1 year after 80 than he did with you in all of your youth. Come on, please believe God. Do I have to beg you to believe God?
I believe.
Don't, I know you do. Amen. My God, I know you do. That's why I'm here right now. Amen. Because I got a partner. Now, I tell people all over the country, I got a church. And they look at me, and they say, what else? It's Jubilee Christian Center. They say, well, that must be an enormous church. I said, it is. It's enormous in faith. It's enormous in love. It's enormous. Listen, all churches are not designed to be 10,000 member churches. I pastored a 10,000 member church, and I'll be real honest with you, I'm much more at home right here than I was there. Because I had people right there that were a bunch of racists. I found that out when we started busing in all the poor people. We bused in six busloads, 80 people in a bus, six of them. That's 480 people a week my last year. I did that on purpose. I took care of them once every Sunday. We'd go down, Eldred Sawyer did it, Roger. Y'all know that story. He's a multimillionaire now. He's the holiest man alive, my doctor told me. You know why he told me that? He did a body x-ray of him. He had a 5 through and through. Y'all know what that means? He'd been shot 5 times with gunfire and never hit a vital organ. Had holes all the way through him. Said the holiest man I ever met. He ran a game. And his need was $1,000 a day for his heroin addiction when he came to my church. Now, we've been running a home through that man right there since 1986 that has just been underwritten by millions and millions and millions of dollars, because we own a farm that's paid for. We got a freestanding building with a gymnasium paid for. We got 3 different facilities that are paid for. Y'all listening to me right now? That's Eldred. Amen. There's my treasure. There's my treasure. There's my treasure sitting out there, that young man, Rocky. Here's my treasure right here, Bill and Renee. Amen. Geraldine, you and David, y'all are my treasures in the Lord. And so they didn't know what to do, but they knew how to shift their eyes. What are you looking at right now? Your problem or Jesus? The second thing they did, they knew how, secondly, to seek the Lord. Now it was quoted earlier, and that's why I said I really didn't have to get up here today, because everybody's already said everything I was going to say. Without faith, Pastor David said a minute ago, without faith, it is what? Impossible. Somebody say impossible. It didn't say improbable. It didn't say there is a slight possibility. No, it is impossible. Without living on a substance of things hoped for and an evidence, but it's a substance. Somebody say substance. Somebody say substance is real. But I'm hitting this pulpit because I'm hitting some substance. When I'm in faith, I'm in substance. I already have it. Though I haven't yet experienced it in the natural, it's already mine. So they knew how to seek the Lord with prayer and fasting. This is the second thing they did. Until that word that had been spoken dropped so down deep into their spirit, they weren't afraid and they weren't dismayed anymore. They knew how to seek the Lord. Some of us right now need to go on a, it says, without faith it's impossible to please him, but those that covet in him must believe, number one, that he is really, really real. This thing you're hearing is substantial. It's real. And he is a rewarder, not of the casual inquirer. But he's a rewarder of those who what? Diligently. That is their life pursuit. The reason they're breathing in the morning is to wake up and say, I love you, Jesus. Did you know yesterday morning I woke up and I was in this dream seeing this thing this man prophesied last night to me? And all I was doing when I woke up was this. I shouted, man, oh, I love you, Jesus. I woke up in the morning and I didn't even know I was awake yet and I was worshiping. I was speaking in tongues. This isn't something I started doing because I'm excited as a kid. But it's growing on me and I'm getting worse. Y'all understand what I just said? This case of the can't help it is growing on me. I'm getting worse. Amen. Y'all think I'm going to settle down? Brother Knesset said, Larry, man, if you keep going this way, you're going to make A.A. Allen sing calm. Just the old timers know what that means. But now he would say, you already there, brother. You already come over. Because you got worse. Amen. Wake up. Praise him. Wake up. Not as a casual informant. Let me go straighten my face. Get all clean. That's okay. Take a shower so you don't turn people off. even if it didn't happen, they were like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They weren't going to turn to the left. They were going to bow. They were going to bend. And thank God they weren't going to burn. Amen.
Yeah.
Somebody give him the glory.
Yeah. Yeah.
Get a better reward. I don't know what that could be. But I didn't provide. And so they knew how to seek, not as casual inquirers, but as diligent believers, as diligently sought him. Number three, they knew how to then listen. And the word of the Lord, they came a second time. Now, not through the prophet, but the king now. It had dropped down in his spirit. See? After he sought the Lord on that word, they were seeking God all the way through here. But then the king gets up. And I'm talking about the man that had spiritual authority to tell him what to do. And listen to what he said. And y'all know this verse. You've heard it all your life. But please ask the Lord to drop it into your spirit one more time. Jehoshaphat bowed his head, all the inhabitants of Jerusalem. And he says to them, he said, tomorrow, he said, don't be afraid nor be dismayed. He says, trust in the Lord, and you're going to be established. Believe God. You'll be established. And then said, honor and trust and obey the prophets, and you will prosper. Now hold on to that word for just a second. You will prosper. If a word of the Lord comes to you by someone you trust as a prophet, because you've seen the evidence. E.V. Hill dedicated my building. And I said a minute ago, I brought in those 480. That was my ticket out of Rockwell, because I brought in the poor people in my plot. White folks, they were speaking into their arm. Y'all know what I mean? My security people, one of them went to the bathroom. They broke them off and put them in that 10,000-seat auditorium way up in the corner. I said, no, they're sitting down here in the front like the Bible says in James. I did that. And I said, when they're not welcome to sit there, y'all are not welcome to sit there. I don't care what you think you gave to this church. With all due respect, I leave this church and give it for my daddy. And he does what I tell him to. Because he believes I'm a prophet. He knows he's seen my life. And the long story short is, when they would not receive the poor, I knew that church was going down.
Right.
The Bible teaches over and again to love the poor. Care for the poor. And when you're on your bed of sickness, God will remember you over and over and over. I mean, there's so many scriptures I can't tell you. When the poor come in, find a way to help them if you can. Don't feed a drug addict, but take him to the Delta Cafe and let him off for $25 and watch him go in there and buy food. Y'all hear what I'm trying to say? And so you see here, he says, trust the prophet. He said, obey the prophet and you will prosper. And it says, then he appointed singers. Now this is the last thing. Y'all know this, and that's why this was so important today. They knew how to obey, believing God, obeying the prophet. They knew how to stand still and just worship God right in the face of their enemies. With their eyes set on Jesus, not standing there trembling like a bunch of scared children, with all due respect, with great boldness, they stood right in the face of their enemy. They worshiped their God, and they believed the word of the prophet. You don't need to fight. God's going to fight for you. And the Bible says God set ambushments, but they began to pray. It does not say when they finished their song. It says when they started their song. The moment you open your mouth today, Bill Morris, when the singers in this house open their mouth, the angels are loosed. Angels are activated through worship. Saith the Lord of hosts. The tithe and the offering also activates. The Lord of hosts means Lord of hosts. Host means the host of the angelic forces. They're loose at that obedience. But the moment they began to sing, Bill, when you began to sing, you may feel nothing other than obedience to your calling. But that moment, God starts moving for the people of God. That's how valuable you guys are to God. Bill. And you have been as long as I've been. I've never been in a service yet. It didn't happen. And I've been in a lot of church with these people, with all due respect. It's like Roger and Sarah, the same way. When they get up and start worshiping, I don't have to worry about God's presence working among the people. It's going to happen. I just try to stay out of the way. I just try to speak the word, get out know the rest of the story. How that the Lord set ambushments against the enemies. That which they could not do for themselves, God did for them. Say, Lord, do it for me. Amen. Come on, come on. Do it. They heard God. They believed God. Then they believed the word of the Lord that came through God's authority, Jehoshaphat. The man of God stood up and said, now, believe God, you're going to be established. Trust me, and you're going to prosper mightily. Well, they had no idea that the Lord would set ambushments. They didn't know how God was going to do it. It's not your job to figure it out. God has no responsibility to explain it to you how he's going to do it. But if you will do what he said to do, what to do when you don't know what to do, I may get anything out of this beside me. I'm about to preach myself to a running habit. Amen. I mean, y'all understand what I mean? This is strong medicine for a weak heart. Put your eyes on Jesus. This is not complicated. What are you saying? If he says, rear back and fight, you better get you a slingshot. You better get you a sword. You better go to work. But if he says, stand still and see, you've got to hear God for real. Not quoting the scripture from somewhere 2,000 years ago or 4,000 years ago, with all due respect. You stand still then. There's a time to speak and there's a time to shut up. There's a time to get up five smooth stones and throw one of them. There's another time just to sing a song. So you hear God. And they stood there fearlessly without any depression with their eyes steadfastly on Jesus, and the armies of Moab and Ammon and half of Mount Seir, half of the Syrians, they were all around them about to just mutilate, devastate them, completely annihilate them. And this is what you heard. The Lord is good. The song of the Lord came. And his mercy endures forever. God Almighty was warring angels, and the enemies started killing each other. And there were so many of them dead. By the time God got through fighting for them, I could just see Jehoshaphat. Now, can't you see this? He said, go out and gather up the spoil. So they go out the first day, and they gather up all they can. And this is the whole army of Israel out there. We're not talking about 40 people getting something. We're talking maybe 100,000 people against 600,000. But there's about 400,000 of them dead, the rest of them ran. But when they go out there and start gathering up, they worked 24 hours. I guarantee they worked nonstop. And they came back and said, sir, we couldn't get it done. He said, well, then get a little rest and go back the next day. They worked a second day. Couldn't gather it all up. Wow. I don't know if anybody's listening to this. But God is wanting to put his people, if we're living in a better covenant.
That's right.
How many believe you're in a better covenant?
Yes.
This is Old Testament stuff. This is Old Testament revelation. If we're living in a better covenant, the second day they gathered it all up, and they couldn't gather it all up. It took 3 days to gather up the spoil. And they named the valley of Berachah. And in Hebrew, the word Berachah is the word blessing. So they went from bewilderment, total bewilderment, to unprecedented blessing. Can I tell you that God is right now in your day, in this hour, now before your face, wanting to fight for you just like that. To take you from bewilderment to blessing, and to stand you up and to set you up, not so you can say, look at me, what I have done, so that the God of Israel can be blessed and praised, who alone is worthy of all the glory. He's not trying to bless you so you can get fat and happy on your blessing. He's blessing you to be a conduit to the world that is lost right now and getting more lost. I don't like to be more lost than lost. But I'm telling you, the world is getting crazier and crazier. The ideological insanity that is supposed to be at the highest ranks of our government, not to count the what's going on globally with things we can't deal with because we don't have the capacity. We're not getting out of this thing by the brain thrust of Washington, D.C., or by our Army, Air Force, Navy, or Marines, or even the Special Forces. We're not getting out of this by our money because we're so far in debt. Now China's making commercials that are on our network television, and a Chinese man is lecturing a bunch of Chinese students and says, now we own them. And all the Chinese, red communists, atheists, are laughing on our television. You know why? It's true. And you're in Tulsa, Oklahoma, so that's not touching me. It will. Unless you hear what the man of God says today. Hear now what the Lord says. Believe God and be established. Obey his prophets and you will prosper. And watch God fight for you. What are you going to do? What did I tell you? Shift your eyes. Get your eyes off of what has bewildered you, what is facing you that you cannot fight on in the flesh and win. If you can do it in the flesh, go ahead and win it. But if you need God involved, get your eyes off of the situation. Put your eyes on Jesus. Then listen for the word of the Lord as you diligently seek him, and he will speak to you. My sheep, hear my voice. But they did one more thing. They followed me. The definition of a sheep is somebody that doesn't just hear. Well, I don't hear God. Well, okay, you better look out. Get saved. Call on the name of the Lord while there's time. While you're sitting there, say, Jesus, have mercy on me. And he'll save you where you're sitting. But if you know him, listen to me. And then what he says, do, just do it. He'll turn the water into wine. It may appear that he's 4 days late, but he's about to raise your dead. It may appear that things have gone completely wrong when you had heard of, when all you knew that he said he did it, but then nothing else happened for a while. He's loving you in secret. He's down after the crucifixion getting the keys of death out of the grave, and he ain't telling you about what he's doing, but he's doing more for you in secret than he would be if he was standing right in your face. He says, I'll be all right, baby, here's a cup of coffee. Y'all hear what I just said? He is taking care of business for you in silent seasons. Delays are not denials in this sense, because God is doing stuff that he doesn't have to explain to you. As long as you're seeking without fear and standing there with eyes open. Oh, and then praise him. My God, this place right here, is a praising place. I love it so much. I love being here. Why? Because when I get in this place right here, all I got to do is put my eyes on Jesus and start praising him and see what Geraldine says next. Amen. Let Pastor David put his hands on me and pray for me. I love being here because the man on the back row that sits there with a look on his face of utter humility and brokenness and purity before God. My God! He's thinking about what he's going to do for God. I know you. Y'all know me too. And I'm so proud of you. I want to tell you, when you praise him, you're beautiful, because praise is beautiful. And when they began to praise, the Lord followed them. So let's do something. Let's turn our eyes on Jesus. Would you do it with me right now? Take your eyes off of whatever you can't figure out how you're going to get through it. How you're going to change your own heart about circumstances that broke you to pieces. You can't fix you. He heals the brokenhearted. Somebody here with a broken heart today, you can't heal yourself. You can't will yourself into healing. You can't even hardly confess yourself into it. You can say, Lord, you came to heal the brokenhearted. And you can say it and say it and say it until finally one day he says, but see, that faith came through speaking that word. Praise God. Somebody lift a hand to him and say, I'm going to diligently. The Bible says those that diligently seek him. And I not a casual inquirer, but a diligent seeker. God, I'm going to seek you. Now let's do a little bit of repenting with our hands lifted. Because you see, God's not mad at you. I'm going to go ahead and tell you. He took wrath out on the cross. He really did. Now, he has wrath, but he is love. And his wrath, as long as you're turned toward him, even in your heart, is not aimed at you. It's already been erased through the death of the cross. I don't think y'all heard what I said. Now, you may mess up, but as long as your heart's still turned to him, he's not out to hurt you in any way. He has nothing bad planned. Now, if he has to chasten you, that's not bad. That's good. But hear what I'm saying. Turn your eyes on him and say, I'm going to seek you diligently. Just tell him right now. And if you're afraid, I want you to repent of fear right now. I know that sounds strange. Fear not as a commandment, not as a vision. If you're depressed, say, Lord, I forgive me for being depressed. Because you said, rejoice in the Lord always. So when I'm stuck in a jail, I got something to rejoice about. When I'm stuck in my own prison, and there's all kinds of prisons, ladies and gentlemen, all different kinds of prisons, praise him. Set your eyes on him and say, Lord, I'm going to trust you. Come on now, come on. Dr. Lea always turned the house into the house of prayer. I ain't done my job. I will trust you with all my heart. I'm going to stop leaning. That's what the Hebrew idiom means there. It means stop leaning. Stop it. It's like God saying, stop it. Stop leaning on your own understanding. In all your ways, know him. That is, call to him. Hear from him. Not just Jesus, I'm going to pray a little bit to you. No, I'm going to know you in this thing. I'm going to know if I should have that operation. Once that doctor said to me, you are dying, I didn't say operate on me. I said, Jesus, I'm not afraid. I'm not dismayed. Yeah, I'm hurting. So what? That may just come to me, well, you want to give me double grace. I'm looking at you, Lord. What do I do? He said, I sent that man to close up that hernia and take your colon out of there. I said, okay. Go ahead and operate, Doc. The next day, it happened. And in 2 days, I was up, and by the end of the week, I was preaching. Somebody said, Larry, you're going to commit suicide by preaching. I said, what a way to go. Amen. But I'm not going to die. I'm going to live. Amen. I'm going to see the vision that I dreamed last night and was prophesied word for word. Not before last, I dreamed it, and word for word last night, a man I'd never met before. Grounded in this prayer ministry 25, 30 years ago, been carrying his family now into high stratus of the music world. And the anointing on him so powerful, he prophesied word for word. I believe the prophets. Yes. And I'm believing the God who gave me the revelation. I saw it and I know what to do. I ain't telling it yet. Why? Because it ain't time to tell it. But I am going to tell you this. If you'll stand there then and just worship God, today is going to release angels. Anytime God gives you a promise, it's a change of seasons. There's a releasing of angels. He always gives you an assignment. Go fill up the water pots. Bring me the 5 loaves and 2 fishes. He always gives you an assignment, always. Because he told the little widow already at Zarephath, now there's a man of God coming. Because he told Elijah, there's a woman already prepared to take you in. And the first thing he said, bring me first. Now that sounded so selfish, but it wasn't. He was interested in her life. And ladies and gentlemen, whether you believe me or not, I'm telling you God's truth. I'm interested in the life of Jubilee Church. I see
Jesus. What an anointing in this place. I've never done this at this church, nor will I ever do it again unless I hear it. Lord said, just put buckets here at the front and start praising. He said, ask the people, and listen to this, ask the men and the women to make a commitment to sow over the next 6 months, $300, through this church into this prayer ministry. Because this church already supports this prayer ministry. And give some of it today. Because what's going to happen is I'm going to go to the bank. I'm literally going to go and start on what you do right now. I don't care. Because I'm not afraid. Not dismayed. I'm going back. And I'm going to start the process that has to be started. I got to do it this week. But the deal is, I mean, when I get back home, it'll be 5 days before I get home. I'm going to ask y'all to make a commitment over 6 months to sell $300. That's a little bit of money. For some of you, it's a lot of money. For others, if God didn't tell you to do it, don't do it. But I'm asking you to, because I know that little bit right there is going to do something to keep this word moving for the next, I'm going to tell you how long, for 15 years nonstop. David has already taken care of his times six. But the Holy Spirit said, put something in on that $300 seat today. And if you can do the whole thing today, just do it. But if you can't, then forget about it. Roger Lance came yesterday. He did not even know what the Lord had said for me to say. And handed me a check for $300. Blew my mind, but really didn't. But did. Because I love God to work. But the Lord said the big deal now is the receiving, not the giving. There's a study on receiving that we've got to get. Amen. Because we've learned a lot about sowing. We've learned very little about receiving. And I don't have time right now to talk about that much. I know much about it, but I've never talked much about it. I've been doing stuff for years and years and years to receive. But there now is coming an anointing to teach on how to receive and how to sow. But trust me on this one, whoever sows whatever into these buckets, God may not speak to you about what I just said, but this is something to keep this ministry doing what it's supposed to do for the next 15 years, this morning. But beyond that, and this is for your sake, you start praising. Just obey the problem. You'll prosper. If you can do it today, do it. If you can do all of it today, do it. If you can do a part of it, and David knows who you are, and I'll let him track this. I don't need to be involved in it at all. Please, David, just help me. But God will honor this in such a way that I will promise you 15 years of Jesus' tarry. That's how long I was given. 2 years ago, so I've got 20 years done what I'm about to do. I was only in Rockwall 11 years, ladies and gentlemen. And so something is about to break loose. It's going to make Rockwall look like nothing, look like a Sunday school place. Father, you and I know something. And this church is my only church. I have one more now, and it's in Kansas City. And it tag team. Because of David Sears. Lord, I ask you to bless the people as they sow. But beyond their sowing, let them just get up here and start working. Everybody get an eye open and say, Lord, what should I do? Listen to him. Pray is what? It's talking in here. Everybody get ready on something. Everybody get an eye open. Everybody get ready to walk with it. Amen. But while you're doing it, we're going to be setting ambushments against the enemy.
Pastor David will dismiss the service ordinarily. And if he might want to say something else, I don't know if he wants to say anything. I pray he would, but we're going to worship as we walk with our offering. We're going to put the offering on the offering receptacles in the altar. What to do when you don't know what to do? Shift your attention. Diligently seek what you hear, believe, and then listen for the voice of authority telling you what to do. And then just pray. And God will provide for you. My God, I couldn't preach that any better by standing in front of 100,000 people. And today, you have me standing here because there's a company that has stood with me. Now you, Lord, stand with them. Every man, every woman, every obedient servant in this house, show your mighty hand. So much so that when I return the next time, whenever that is, I pray I won't have to tell about getting healed again. Dear God, I'm tired of that. Thankful for the healing, but I'm tired of having to tell it because I don't like being sick. Amen. And you know that you and I have something on that. But yet, Lord, thank you for healing me every time you have. Let me have a testimony to tell that God is alive. Everybody gets something in their hand. They always said, let's go to get the prophet. They said, well, we don't have anything to give. That's interesting. They always brought something. They never went empty-handed to it. And I'm not building myself up or my office gifting. I'm not abusing it here. I'm standing in it for your sake. The prophets not do this. Apostles don't do this. It's because they're afraid of the people or the pastors. And resultingly, the churches cannot see miracles. And that's why, by and large, the church in the West has stayed small compared to the church in the East. That is the eastern part of the world. They're blowing up in Congress, China. They're blowing up in Korea. They're blowing up Southeast Asia. They're blowing up in rice paddies, having revivals that we have never dreamed of in America. Churches in Russia right now, 50 and 60,000 people. Jesus. God, I'm going to ask one thing before I take my seat. In lieu of what is going on through this church and its connection to me and this apostolic church. Give David Sears the desire of his heart. I don't know what it is, but I know he has delighted himself in the Lord. He has loved to take care of his children and his grandchildren. I know he has obeyed you and stood faithful. All I ask as a man of God, let him search his own heart out until he knows what it is, and then write it down and watch it come to pass. In Jesus' name. Are y'all ready to worship God? Because my preaching is done. The anointing is here so powerful right now, I'm almost out in the spirit. I'm going to ask you all to bring the offering receptacles are here already. Thank you. If you have an offering, bring it. I'm going to ask the worshipers to come first with your offering. Whatever you're sowing, bring it with you. And I'm going to ask whoever how y'all want to do it with Bill and Renee, my God, whoever else is supposed to lead worship, the worshipers to come. And let's spend the next 10 minutes or so just worshiping. When you begin to sing, now remember this, as they began to worship, the Lord set ambushes. The moment they began to sing, the battle is over. Today, in Jesus' name. God is in this place. He's moving by his spirit. Come on, singers. Come on. If you've got something to sow, you want to sow something toward what I said, do it now. Here we go. Amen.
Thank you.
such great expectation. I've heard that message preached. I've preached it. Everybody ever preacher in town preached it. But it's never better. I've never had it impact me. See, that's the power of the revelation of the word. He can preach it, preach it, preach it, read it, read it, read it. One day, it chops off the page. And it gets inside of you, and that's when the spirit of faith takes over. You can believe God for the impossible. Because nothing is impossible if you've got the faith to believe God. Well, I'm going to hush. I'll tell you what, Father, I want to thank you today for every second of this service. From the time we started until this very moment of finish. I pray the ears of every person here, I pray their heart receive it, and they have a will to be obedient to the word of God, that we may receive your word and become that conduit, that blessing to be a blessing, that the kingdom of God may be established in Jesus' name. Lord bless you. Have a great afternoon. Thank you for being here. I'll go home.